3, 2, 1, 0, and liftoff.
Discovery, roger. Go for deploy.
Roger, all, Discovery.
Hi there, and welcome to the Astro McGill Podcast. This is a podcast series in which we discuss current topics in astrophysics with professional astronomers visiting us here in the physics department at McGill. I'm Robert Archibald.
I'm Eric Madsen.
And with us today, we have Dr. Steve Kowaler. He's a professor in the Department of Physics and Astronomy at Iowa State University, and he explores the interior structures and evolution of stars. Welcome to the podcast.
Great to be here. Thank you.
Can you tell us a little bit about the questions that you're trying to answer in your research?
Sure. The thing that I'm most worried about is that we've never seen the insides of stars before. We've studied stars. We've studied them almost entirely by looking at what they look like on the outside. Knowing what's going on the inside requires knowledge of physics and some trust that computer models and all that sort of jazz works on the insides without ever seeing it directly. Nowadays, though, there's techniques that we've developed that we're now using to see inside of stars, to sense the interiors directly. And we're learning a lot of new things about stars. We're also, thankfully, learning that a lot of what we thought we knew in the past is actually correct.
So what techniques do you use to probe the insides of stars?
Well, we have to start with a computer model because that's the best guess that we have. So you start with a guess of what the inside of a star should look like. Then you use that model to predict how the star's outsides respond to sort of turbulence, shaking on the inside. Stars aren't quiet and stable objects like a glass of water, like the one sitting here. They've got a lot of motion, sort of like a boiling pot of water instead. And how that boiling affects the surface is that it raises hot gases up and cooler gases drop below, and you end up with what is really kind of a circulation pattern at the surface. Now, you can see this pattern if you look at the sun. Now, don't look at the sun, right? If you look at the sun carefully, you can see that the surface isn't smooth. It's sort of mottled. This is independent of sunspots. When you see sunspots, that's something else. But this modeling that you see on the sun, if you find a good picture of the sun on the internet, go and take a look. That pattern changes over time. By using a model of the inside of the sun, you can predict how that outside will change over time, and then see if the model looks like what the actual data that you get tells you. Now, for other stars, it's a lot more difficult because you can't see that whole surface. You can't resolve it into structures. But you can see the net effect of these bright and dark patches not quite canceling each other out. And by measuring the brightness of a star extremely exquisitely precisely, you can see what the time variability of the output of the star is. And then you go back to your model, tune your model as best you can to match those variations, and see how much that newly tuned model is different than what you originally thought.
How much are stars uniform the whole way through, or are they more like the Earth, where we think of the crust and different layers all the way through?
Great question. Most stars change significantly in important properties as you go from the surface to the center. First of all, they get hotter. The surface of a star is almost always the coolest part, and so the temperature increases as you go in. Unlike the Earth, which has very definite boundaries between the crust and the mantle and the core, a star's transformations as you go in are a little more subtle. In our sun, for example, you start at the surface, it's got this mottled texture. As you go down below the surface, you get into regions that are a little bit less turbulent. And then when you're about 30% of the way to the core, all that turbulence vanishes. And you enter a new layer, going from the turbulent, what we call the convective layer, to the radiative layer, where the material is nice and quiet. Well, it's blisteringly hot, it's millions of degrees, but it's not bubbling, it's not churning, it's a very, very calm place.
Do we know why that is?
Well, yeah, the turbulence that you have in the outer part of the sun is the sun's best way of getting that heat out from the very, very hot core to the surface. The surface of the sun is close to 0 degrees. It's the coldness of space, even during the day. But below the surface, it's extremely hot. You've got to get all that heat out quickly. For a star like the sun, the best way to get that out is by taking hot globs of material and having them float to the surface and radiate to space. And then that cooled material drops down and you end up circulating. Once you're deep enough in the sun and hot enough in the sun, the temperature doesn't change as much. And so you don't have to get the heat out that quickly. And so it can calmly transport energy just by photons filtering through. So as you dive down through this outer 30%, where it's really turbulent, if you imagine listening, you'd be dead. But if you weren't dead and you listened, you would hear sort of like what you hear at the beach or in a vicious windstorm. You would hear this loud, staticky, rumbly thing. But then once you cross the bottom into the radiative zone, into the hot radiative zone, it would just go instantly quiet. Well, not instantly quiet, but it would gradually die out until when you were in that radiative zone, pure, utter, blisteringly hot silence all the way down into the core.
And this is all information that we can get by looking at variations in light at the surface of the sun?
That's what we can do to confirm that this picture is right. You can make this model of the sun without worrying about those details by just putting together enough matter of the right composition and letting nuclear reactions in the core happen and modeling the transport of energy and so on. You could come up with a pretty good solar model. But to figure out precisely where you transition from that convective loud region to the quiet region requires these oscillations to refine that physics.
What kind of time scale do we see these variations over?
The typical time scale is about 5 minutes. So if you were sitting close to the surface of the sun, again, you'd be dead. But if you weren't, you would see a region roughly the size, I don't know, of Prince Edward Island, rising and getting hot and then falling and cooling on a time scale of 5 or 10 minutes. And so you can, with a powerful telescope, preferably above the Earth's atmosphere, see these regions appear and disappear on a reasonably short time scale.
So speaking of a powerful telescope above Earth's atmosphere, I know that we've never put one up there expressly for this purpose, but I do also happen to know, having just listened to your talk, that there is one up there conveniently usable for this purpose.
That's the Kepler spacecraft, which we've rebranded the K2 mission. Yeah, Kepler was launched in March of 2009 to measure the brightness of hundreds of thousands, well, 150,000 stars to very high precision, the kind of thing that we would want to do. But Kepler's purpose wasn't to look at these tiny oscillations of stars. Its purpose was and remains to find planets around other stars. And now that worked fabulously. Unfortunately, or fortunately, for the stellar astronomers, Kepler's observations of planets take up one tiny fraction of the amount of actual data that Kepler got. In order to see those planets, it had to observe these stars continuously for years, but the actual planetary signal is very brief and only in a handful of the stars in the sample. So all of that rest of that data we can use to look for these oscillations.
Planets are a really different signal than this. Like, there's no way you're going to confuse them and mix them up and think this star oscillation is actually a Jupiter-sized planet or some such?
Thankfully, they're very different. When a planet crosses in front of a star, it provides a little tiny dip in the brightness. So the star is roughly constant over time. As a planet crosses the disk, which it does for a normal planet around a typical star in just a few minutes, you see the brightness of the star drop pretty quickly by a few parts per 100,000 or so. And then it stays low, it changes slowly for a while, and then after a few hours, 3, 4, 5 hours, it pops back up again. And so it's basically a level shift from high to low. I just realized I'm showing you with my hand. And on a podcast, that's not necessarily the best way for the rest of the people listening to see it. So I'll put my hand down.
For our listeners, his hand is going from slightly higher to slightly lower as he says this.
In a very precise way. So it's a very simple drop down, drop back up. The oscillations are sort of flickering up and down around a mean value. They don't change abruptly and don't stay at the same level as long as is in a planetary signal. So with just a little bit of practice, it's pretty easy to see the difference.
And what planet causing a dip of a few parts in a million, what sort of level of variations do we see from the oscillations of the stellar interior?
Well, for the oscillations, we see a signal about the same size. Again, that's sort of a fortunate accident. When Kepler was designed and the U.S. taxpayers footed the bill of $600 million, they were building a spacecraft to find planets, and the parameters of that spacecraft were tuned to find Earth-like planets around Sun-like stars. So given the size of the Earth, the size of the Sun, it needed to be precise to a few parts per million. The mission was conceived, built, funded, and executed to find planets, but it's the same instrument that those of us that do these stellar oscillation studies, the same instrument that we would have designed given the same amount of money. So since looking at planets around other stars, admittedly, is a whole lot sexier than looking at stellar vibrations, it was a lot easier for them to try and pose and put together this mission.
So you guys leapt onto this pretty much immediately when the plans for Kepler were laid out?
Absolutely. Well, the two communities have some overlap. There are some stellar astronomers that were pioneers in the exoplanet game. Ron Gilliland is one name that comes to mind. He was at the Space Telescope Science Institute at the time. Another is Tim Brown. There are several people that had a foot in both worlds, and they were clear at the start of the development of the Kepler mission that it would be very valuable to do this as well. And so without their help, the access of stellar astronomers to Kepler data would have taken a lot longer.
You mentioned you could help the people looking for planets with Kepler by figuring out how big their stars are. Could you tell us a little about that?
Yeah, they need us, not as much as we need them, but it's a symbiotic relationship. The signal of a planet crossing a star is, as I mentioned, a drop in the light. The bigger the planet for a given size star, the deeper the drop. So a bigger planet blocks more of the light of the star. But you need to know the size of the star in order to get the size of the planet. So you could imagine you see a signal that drops a certain amount. You don't know whether that's a big planet orbiting a bigger star or a small planet orbiting a small star. So by measuring the size of the star independently from the planet folks, you've then effectively measured the size, the radius of the planet. Using these oscillations, one of the key parameters, if you will, of the oscillations is the time scale for the variability. Smaller stars, denser stars, vary fast. Less dense stars vary more slowly. It's a perfect analogy of the violin versus a cello. You can listen to a violin from behind a curtain and know you're listening to a violin and not a cello simply by the average pitch of the sound. And stars behave the same way. So by listening to the pitch of these variations, we can measure the size of the star, and then the planet people use that information to get precise measures of the size of the planets that they found. And I should say that it's because of this ability to give them precise radii that they were particularly eager to get stellar astronomers looking at their data.
It's always nice when these things work out.
Oh yes, they're very nice people.
So in addition to how big stars are, in your talk you mentioned being able to see how old they are by, again, with these pressure waves?
Yes, finding the ages requires a little bit more thought and work, but when you listen to the stars, the analogy is to sound waves, you'll hear a certain tone, but it's actually made up of several tones. It's a chord. And from the notes in the chord and how tightly they are wrapped together, you can measure the density of the star and how the density changes with depth. Now, as a star ages, the density of the core increases, but the average density doesn't so much. So it's as if material is piling into the center of the star and coming from the outside onto the inside, and that changes that extra sort of spacing within the chord. So if you think of a three-note chord where the three notes are one step apart versus half a step apart, you can hear the difference between those two chords, even though the note itself is the same. Listening to a star, identifying those chords, and then comparing them with models, we can tell, given the set of frequencies, what the age of the star is in order to produce that sort of note.
And using this method, you mentioned one really cool star that's in the Kepler field in your talk. Would you like to tell us a bit about that?
That would probably be Kepler 444. The easiest of the Kepler numbers to remember. You only have to remember one number and say it three times. Kepler 444 was a surprise. It's a star in the Kepler field that is older than almost any other star in the Kepler field. Now, most of the stars in the Kepler field are about the age of our sun, maybe a little bit younger. That's about 4 or 5 billion years. But Kepler 444 appeared to be a much older star, a star formed just 2 billion years after the Big Bang, compared to our sun, which was formed nearly 10 billion years after the Big Bang. Because it was formed so long ago, it's made of almost pure hydrogen and helium. There's very little carbon or oxygen or silicon or neon or magnesium in that star. Now, if you want to make planets around a star that has almost none of the raw materials to make planets, then you would think that such an old star wouldn't have planets around it. But what we found with Kepler is that this star, Kepler 444, has five planets. Five small rocky planets, much smaller than the Earth, in very, very tight orbits around it. Now, why is this interesting? It tells us that planet formation has been going on in our galaxy for almost the entire history of the galaxy, not just the last 4 or 5 billion years. It also tells us that stars, not just around the sun in the disk of the Milky Way, but in the halo surrounding the Milky Way, our planet hosts. And if you think about it, how the distribution of planets in the galaxy has just expanded with the discovery of this one system. We knew that stars like the Sun were commonly planet hosts from earlier Kepler data. But now this whole second population, this old family of stars, appears to host planets as well. And that increased the volume of our galaxy, populated by planet hosting stars, tremendously just with the discovery of this one object.
So it looks like planets have been part of the universe since pretty early in its existence.
Exactly, since much earlier than we thought. Now, we still haven't answered the paradox of how do you make planets when you make a star that has so few of the raw materials. We're struggling with that, but nature isn't having a problem with that at all. Something is funny that we just don't know about.
What's the future of studying the oscillations of stars, and what more can we learn from this phenomenon?
Well, Kepler finished taking data in the primary mission in May of 2013, which as of today is nearly 3 years ago. We're still going through the data that Kepler took. There's still a ton of data that has barely been looked at. I talked about one of those objects, this oscillating star in an open cluster, that we've just now gotten to the data after many years because we've been so busy with other things. So there'll be a long time before we're done fully exploiting data that already exist. Kepler's new form, what we call K2, is looking at stars in different parts of the sky, and that's ongoing for the next, hopefully, 2 years or so, where we'll be able to look at a whole different sets of stars than we were able to do with Kepler.
Could you just talk about K2 for a minute? I just think it's a really cool idea of a broken telescope.
Well, the telescope was fine. It was just the pointing that was the problem. The original Kepler mission stared at the same part of the sky continuously for 4 years. That was part of the power of the telescope, was it looked at the same stars and gave us a nice long record. In order to point at that one point in the sky, though, it needed stability on three axes. Just like a ship at sea or an airplane, you need to control pitch, that's up and down motion, yaw, which is side to side motion, and then roll, rolling about the forward axis. So that required three independent, what we call reaction wheels. Kepler was launched with four reaction wheels, so they had some redundancy. A couple of months after launch, one of the reaction wheels failed. Fine, you need three, it had three. But 4 years and a day after they started taking data, another reaction wheel failed. It was down to two, which meant that in order to maintain pointing, they would have to use thrust, which means use fuel, which means a very short lifetime, because they had only a little bit of fuel on the spacecraft. And so there was a scramble on to see if they couldn't rescue the mission. The Kepler mission effectively ended then, though, in the sense of the original target of looking at that one field. But you've heard the term rocket scientist to describe somebody of incredible intelligence and industriousness. The real hero is the rocket engineer, the people that build these spacecraft, get them into orbit, and keep them working. And the rocket engineers stepped in and figured out a way to use the Kepler spacecraft to point it stably, not at the Kepler field anymore, but along the ecliptic, along the orbit of the Earth around the Sun, along the zodiac, by using, to stabilize the roll, light from the Sun. So as sunlight streams past the telescope, it acts like a wind. And by pointing one of the solar collectors into the wind, you get a stability along the roll axis. And as long as they pointed it in the ecliptic, they could, with minimal amounts of fuel, point it a single field stably for up to 80 days or so. And so they re-engineered all the flight software on the spacecraft, all of the data acquisition and transmission software, to support this new mode of observing for roughly 80 to 90 days between repointings along the ecliptic. And this is what we call the K2 mission, the resurrected Kepler, which can still look for planets around stars, but also now can sample different parts of the galaxy, different objects. K2 has observed low-mass stars to look for planets. It's also observing solar system objects. It observed Neptune, which flew through the field of view, and they saw Neptune wobbling because of the motion of Neptune and Triton. They were able to see Triton going around Neptune. Pluto is in a field. Jupiter is in one field. It's an amazing machine that can do a whole lot more science now than the original mission. So in some sense, it's better than it was before. And it will continue to operate this way as long as there's a little bit of money and both remaining reaction wheels stay working.
So what can't it do that it was able to do in its original state?
It can't point out of the ecliptic, out of the plane of the Earth's orbit. It turns out that's okay. It also can't point for longer than 80 or 90 days. So to find an Earth-like planet, you want to be able to point at the same place for 3 years, so you see several transits of the Earth-like planet. You can't do that anymore. Aside from that, the shortened duration of observations, it's as good as ever.
What comes after Kepler, for at least for the science you're doing?
Well, K2 will continue to operate, hopefully until it runs out of gas, at which point they probably will shut it down. But there's a new experiment that should be launched in August of 2017, or maybe later in 2017, called TESS. It's a smaller version of Kepler with smaller telescopes, but that will do what Kepler did, but over the whole sky. And so that's a survey of the entire sky to look for transiting Earth-like planets around Sun-like stars, but also other photometric variability that you can learn a lot from. That's kind of a finder mission for the JWST, the James Webb Space Telescope. Hopefully, TESS will find a planet with an atmosphere around a bright star that JWST can then look at to see if it can detect the atmospheres of those worlds as they transit across their host stars. That would be very exciting. Imagine measuring the composition of the atmosphere of a world and finding molecular oxygen, which it's really hard to imagine without some sort of biological activity on the surface of that planet.
Well, thank you very much, Steve, for joining us today.
Well, it's a pleasure. It's been a long day, but a lot of fun visiting with you.
Yeah, it's been really great to meet you. I'm Eric Madsen.
I'm Robert Archibald.
And you've been listening to the Astro McGill Podcast. Don't forget to follow us on Facebook and Twitter. And until next time, thanks for listening.
We'll stop.
Roger, we'll stop. Discovery, welcome back. A great ending to the new beginning.